We take pride in bringing you the best and offering you information from leaders in a legally technical space. That's why I'm excited to introduce you to Gene Trowbridge and Julian Sidoti, founding partners of the top syndication law firm, Trowbridge Sidoti. They have a legal team with over 88 years of combined legal experience. That team, along with their amazing support staff, has helped clients raise over $3.7 billion in offerings by being dedicated to empowering entrepreneurs to raise capital legally. Because they believe an informed mind makes for solid decision making, Gene and Julian take the time to provide twice monthly live educational webinars where attendees can participate in a Q&A period at the end of the presentation. Visit www.crowdfundinglawyers.net to sign up for the next free webinar or schedule a free consult. Trowbridge Sidoti is a superior choice if you're looking for a team that understands crowdfunding, syndication, Regulation A, private placement memorandums, tenant in common agreements, opportunity zones. They are the experts in getting it done. Visit them at www.crowdfundinglawyers.net.
You know, I've used these approaches with other companies and different agencies, and I think it works well, right? The shortest distance is to run a campaign with, you know, what we'll call the ethical bribe, right? So that's like the free thing. And you say, you know, give me your email in exchange for a free thing. And then they get free thing. And then the end of free thing is the option to continue working with them. For me, it's usually getting people on the phone, right? If it's your e-commerce, it's buying a whatever, some kind of widget or tchotchke, right? Whatever your sales process is, right? So you just think about, it goes add to ethical bribe. The ethical bribe says, if you want to continue, pass directly into my sales process, right? And then they do that. That's the easiest approach. It's the simplest one. It's the one I started with. We still do a ton of traffic that way, and it's really, really valuable. But this gets into where you have to think about your market a little bit. There are, I think it's Eugene Schwartz, who's like one of the classic advertising copywriters. You know, one of the founders of modern advertising, right? And Schwartz's idea was that markets have different levels of sophistication, right? You can start with a market that is completely unaware, both that they have a problem or that there's a solution for that problem. And if you want to market to an audience like that, you have to first get them to become aware that there's a problem, and then that there's a solution, and then that you are the solution, right? So there's multiple steps, right? And you can go all the way up to a market where they are both completely aware of the problem that they have and aware that there are solutions available, and all you have to convince them of is that you're the best solution of all the possible solutions, right? So as like, you know, if you are looking for investors, right, there's a difference between approaching a market that doesn't even know that real estate syndication is a thing, right? They have no idea what that means. They have no idea what it does for them. They have no idea what the benefit might be for like working with one of your clients. So that's one problem. I've got to start all the way at the beginning and tell them all that stuff. Versus an audience that's more sophisticated, that like maybe they know they want to be invested in real estate, but they don't know how. That's a totally different conversation, right?
Right.
Depending on where your market is in that spectrum of sophistication, you kind of need more or less steps, right? So like, if I need to convince someone that they have a problem, and then that they have a solution, and then that that I'm the best solution, I will probably not just do here's an ethical bribe straight into my sales process, because they're not even going to know that they want this thing, right? Like if I said like top 10 benefits of like a really specific kind of real estate investing, and I market that to the average person, they don't know anything about real estate. They don't care. They don't think that applies to them. No one's going to opt into it, right? No one's going to click on that. So instead I might have to, you know, I've got to meet them where they're at. And that might be talking about retirement. That might be talking about cash flow. That might be talking about the economy, like whatever it is, right? So when I'm taking that more, you know, sort of long-term approach, I won't necessarily just hit them with an ethical bribe and go straight into the sales process. What I'm going to try to do then is form that relationship that I was talking about. So I might, for example, run an ad. In fact, I'll use a real-world example. okay? Because I'm doing this now. I will run an ad that says, hey, like, is online marketing right for you? As a real estate investor looking for motivated sellers, you know, there are investors that can really do online marketing now really well, and there are investors where online marketing is not a good fit for them, whether it's their market or whatever. You probably don't know which one you are. Here's a free guide to figuring out which one you are. And there's no opt-in. I don't ask for an email. I don't ask for anything. I literally don't ask for anything. It's just free. Check it out. Right? Now, depending on how I do that, let's say I make that a blog post and all I do is just promote the blog post. All they got to do is click. They don't have to give me their email. They don't have to give me anything. All I'm doing is generating some interest.
When you say ad, did you mean like Facebook ad?
Yeah, I'll talk Facebook here specifically, because I think when you're dealing with an audience that is not actively searching for you specifically, Facebook is still, in my opinion, the dominant ad channel. And I love AdWords. AdWords is a really good example of an ad channel that works for someone who knows what they want already, right? So if you're trying to educate people long-term, Facebook's a much better option. So, you know, let's say I'd like promote my blog post. They go, they get value out of it. They're like, cool. Well, I can show ads just to the people that clicked on that blog post, right? That's called retargeting in Facebook. So I'm saying like, okay, I run that ad promoting the blog post. I don't ask for anything. The people that clicked on that ad and saw my blog post, now they're going to see a different set of ads. That different set of ads might be like, hey, I talk about all sorts of like retirement and real estate investing stuff. I know you're interested in real estate investing. Why don't you just opt in for my mailing list? It's totally free. And I'll give you this other thing of value. So again, leading with value, they're one step into the process now. I still haven't really asked for them for anything other than an email in exchange. Now I have the ability to grow that relationship over time.
I like that. You talked about leading with value.
Absolutely. Always, right? So then it's like, cool. Now they've given me their email. They got more free stuff. Now they like me. And I might put them into an automated sequence in ActiveCampaign, but you could do it in Drip or Infusionsoft or any of these systems, right? Put them into an automated sequence where I'm going to send them an email every day for 5 days that says, hey, you know, you read that blog post and you downloaded my PDF thing, give me your email. Here's the 5 most important things you need to know about using real estate as a retirement vehicle. So here's this, right? Value. Now, in every single one of those emails, I might hint at like what I actually do, right? So if I'm helping people retire with real estate, I might be like, you know, like first email is, you know, most important problem that people run into with their retirement is they don't include real estate at all. They're too scared of it. They think it's scary. They don't realize that there are other options available. Now, it's true. I myself offer these kind of like low risk real estate options to people. So of course I might be biased, but blah, 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 blah. So now it's like, I just said what I did. I still haven't asked them for anything, but now they're like, well, now they're curious, right? By the time I get to like email 3, I will start to say like, by the way, if you want to work together, click this link, jump on the phone with someone on my team, and we'll see if it's a good fit. And that's like as hard as I will pitch them. For a long time.